given. I want you to stand and worship the Lord with us and give Him your best tonight.
Thank you. glorify your name. You are holy, holy. You are God Almighty. There is no power of heaven that can take victory from us. Through the blood of Jesus Christ, the power of your Holy Spirit, and the authority of your word, as Pastor John said tonight, we are victorious. We walk in victory regardless of what circumstances may appear. You have said it and settled it, so it is so in the name of Jesus. And we give you praise in the house. Holy Spirit, come teach us from this word tonight. Speak to our hearts. Mold us and shape us into the image of the precious Son of God, that our minds would be transformed and our hearts would be changed to serve you with even greater urgency and greater fervency. We ask this all in Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen, amen, amen. Good to see you in the house of the Lord. You can be seated. Wow, look how everybody just is already automatically moving back toward the center.
Awesome. Thank you for that. Pastor John didn't even have to say a word tonight. It all worked out well. I'm going to be honest with you. There's a couple of reasons why we do that. And I've told you one before. It keeps me from having to spin my head all the way around the room. I can kind of concentrate right here. But the other thing it does is for our Wednesday night Bible studies, by having you here, it looks like we've got people here. Because when you all spread out that way, it just looks empty. And that's not the message we want to send on YouTube, because we've got a great crowd of people that come out on Wednesday nights, just that when you spread out in an auditorium like this. So thank you for that. And now you know there's more than just me wanting to make you get up out of your seat that we ask you to do that. There's some very practical reasons. My wife went around earlier tonight and handed out sheets of paper that say Wednesday night Bible study survey. And tonight my intention is to wrap up the Sermon on the Mount. So what I'd like for you to do, and you can do this tonight if you can multitask, and some of you may have already gotten started, but I'd like you to list up to five. Now, if you've got 15, just list your top five. If you only have three, list your top three. But if you'll write down some topics, Bible books of the Bible, Bible characters, life issues, different things that we can tackle and examine on Wednesday nights that you would like us to do, if you would please fill that out and get these back to me. There is a place for your name. If you feel like you shouldn't put your name on it, that's okay. But I'll just throw that paper out. No, I'm kidding. I'll look at all of them, and then I'll, as it says down at the bottom, that I'm going to prayerfully pursue where we go and what. But here's what I want us to do on these Wednesday nights that are so important as we break open the Word of God. I always ask God where to go, but I believe God wants to touch His people in the places where they are too, and the things that they need to hear and desire to hear and have questions about. So we take those two things together and we pray over them and see where God will take us. So if you will fill that out for me, and if you finish it tonight, the best thing is to finish it tonight, because if you take it home, it's going to end up where a lot of other papers at your house end up. So if you can do it tonight really quickly before you leave, that'd be great. And you can give it either to me or to my wife or maybe even Miss Robbie. If you can't find either one of us, just hand it to one of the three of us, and we'll get to work on that as we get ready to wrap up. I do want to make an announcement, a couple of announcements. Pastor John's already mentioned Saturday night, first Saturday night prayer. And so I hope that we see many of you come out with us. We are praying, seeking God for revival in Escambia County and revival right here in our community here in Cantonment. And we'll also be taking the needs of the church before the Lord together corporately, and also be taking the individual needs of the body that we'll have, our prayer list and other things that are here. And I got to tell you, it's a beautiful, intimate time with God. And then when we gather at the close, it is a powerful time where our spirits and hearts are joined together with His, and we pray over this. So please come and be a part of it. As I mentioned on Sunday, revival is not going to happen. As bad as we want it, it's not going to happen without prayer. God has a formula, a simple formula for seeking revival. Now, it's up to God to send it, but He wants us to do our part, right? And that formula is to pray and to seek His face. So we're going to do that. Then also next Friday is Golden Harvesters. It's a little early in the month because today is June the 1st. Welcome, June. Welcome, everybody, to June. Wow. Hallelujah. But next Friday is Golden Harvesters. So if you will be attending, plan to attend Golden Harvesters, that's your intention right now, please see Miss Jackie. She would like to know who's coming. And so if you just mob her after the service tonight and let her know that you're going to be coming next Friday, that'll be tremendous. And then there's a very special occasion taking place after the service this Sunday. We were extended an invitation this past Sunday. Pastor John's marrying off one of his girls. Hallelujah. Getting a loud shout. That's going to happen right after service, and the invitation was extended to all of you to stay and to be a part of that very special moment in their lives as Jonae and Tyran tie the knot. Hallelujah. It's good to have Riley home for the summer. Yeah. Hallelujah. Pitcher extraordinaire. We followed him this summer, and I understand you got good news about your scholarship today. Hallelujah. Everybody's praising God about that, including mom and dad. Praise you, Jesus. So, but it's good to have you home for a little while. It's good to see all of you out in the house of the Lord. And to our guests, we make you welcome. I know you don't feel like a guest, but thank you for allowing us to treat you like one tonight. We welcome you, and we're very glad that you're here. We're going to pick up tonight in Matthew chapter number 7. And we left off in verses 9 through 11. And so I want to revisit there for just a moment, and then I want to move right into verse number 12. In Scripture, when we study Scripture, there are many things that we can study for and many aspects that we can look at the Scripture from. Last week, I talked contextually, the context of what Jesus was saying about asking, seeking, and knocking. Also within the context, there are principles that are taught in Scripture that supersede or go beyond just the context and when they're taught. If it wasn't that way, then none of the Bible would apply to us. Right? If it didn't go beyond context, which is when and where and to whom it was said at that moment, then it would not apply to us. But there is application and practical things and principles that are taught within context. So the principle of asking, seeking, and knocking certainly does apply. And I think I left the impression last week that it does not apply what Jesus is teaching here to us asking for what we desire from the Lord. Principally, it does. Principally, it is to seek after God, pursue God, and continue to ask Him. And if we don't get it by asking, then we seek. If we don't get it by seeking, we continue to knock. We don't give up asking what we desire from God. Now, what we want to do is ask according to His will. So the principle of ask, seek, and knock certainly applies to what we seek God for. If we're seeking God for healing or for blessing or provision or whatever it is. Contextually, though, Jesus was talking about pursuing the kingdom, asking that the kingdom be relevant in our life as it is in heaven, let it be on earth in our life, and seeking things of the kingdom. And so I wanted to clarify that because that's going to be important as to where we're going tonight as well. So is everybody good? Everybody follow me? Or y'all going, why in the world did you even... Nobody's going to... A shaking of the head? Or do I need to park right here for a little while? Or can we move on? We're good? All right, we're good. Y'all had me scared for a minute there. I thought... But we'll park if we need to park. Amen. So verse number 12 says this. Now Jesus has just taught all this in verses 1 through 11 of chapter 7, which is just a continuation of the Sermon on the Mount. And he uses the word therefore. So he's saying, in light of all I've just told you, whatever you want men to do to you, do also to them. For this is the law and the prophets. Now what comes out of this passage of Scripture? Do unto others. The golden rule. That's what I was looking for. The golden rule comes from this passage of Scripture. And what Jesus is saying, and by the way, Jesus in this first part from Matthew chapter number 5 all the way through 7:11 is doing expository preaching. He's explaining to the people what he is saying and what Scripture means and what they have read in the prophets and what they have been told in times past and all of those things. So he's doing expository preaching. And now he is moving in verse 12, he is moving to application. Now he wants to help us apply this to our life. So he says, in order for you to accomplish all the things that I've just told you, there's one thing that you need to do and one thing that you need to recognize in relationship to your fellow man. Whatever you want men to do to you, do also to them. Remember he said, don't judge so you won't be judged. Remember that way back up in this, he was talking about turning the other cheek. He was talking about all kind of things in scripture he talks about. So now he's saying, there's one way you can accomplish that. If your heart is after me and you're seeking things of the kingdom, then do unto others what you want them to do to you. So if you want love and respect and harmony and peace, then you treat people with love and respect and harmony and peace. This is a reciprocal life that we live in Christ. And he says, so now, this is what I want you to begin doing with all this information I've given you. Just start treating people like you want to be treated. How many of you want to be treated nice? It's so funny to watch people get upset in a restaurant or in a department store or a big box store or something. And, you know, they're fussing all the way out of the car. All I wanted was those people to be nice to me. And yet they were just vilifying that person behind the counter. Just tearing them apart. Yes, ma'am.
Waitress and managed the restaurant for a number of years, and some of the most rude Sundays was horrible. And even now, when I go out to eat, waitresses, even to this day, will say, we hate Sundays. Christian people, when they leave the church, they come in here and they are, hey, listen. And they don't leave
the tip. That does not apply to anybody in this room, however. But I know I've heard this very same thing. What a poor testimony that the church has with that environment. So that means literally that we're not living this scripture. I mean, as the body of Christ, if that's the reputation. Now, truth be known, there's probably far more nice Christians that go, but people remember the bad ones. It only takes one, right, to ruin it for all of us. But the truth of the matter is we got a lot to live down. So we need to treat people like we want to be treated. And so we need to understand that this is, you know, the golden rule, something everybody learns at some point in their life. A number of those people have no idea that it comes right out of it. It was extrapolated out of this scripture right here. And so Jesus in his sermon to those that had gathered and to his disciples is, treat people well and you'll be treated well. Now, that's the kind of seeds we need to sow. So the golden rule is where Jesus begins his preaching and teaching in an application sort of way. This is how you do it. If you want to see a lot of these things that I've taught you come to fruition in your life, begin by treating people the way you want to be treated. And none of us want to be treated bad. None of us want to be talked about. None of us want to get cursed out. None of us want nobody to leave us a tip, right? If we were working in there, my daughter, I remember when my daughter was working as a, you know, my first job was as a Waffle House cook.
I worked at Waffle House and she
got those orders. And you're talking about bad tippers. We had some bad tippers in Waffle House. But I remember when my daughter started waiting tables, it would just aggravate me when she would come home and tell me stories about how. So bottom line is, if we want to be treated well, we treat other people well, right? Okay, let's move to verse number 13. Verse number 13 says this, enter by the narrow gate. Now, as I read this and we begin to talk about it, I want you to remember what I talked about when I first got started tonight about there are principles within contextual teaching, okay? So we're going to examine both of those tonight. Enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and there are many who go in by it. Because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way which leads to life, and there are few who find it. So let's stop in verse number 14. So we see here Jesus is teaching. Now in context, let's talk about context first, and then we'll get back to the principal part. But in context, he's still talking to people that are pursuing the kingdom. He's talking about people who have chosen to follow him now and want to pursue this kingdom life that is available to us. And so within this context, and I'm telling you, I did even more digging and research this week in commentaries and opinions and study Bibles and everything else and praying and asking the Holy Spirit. But here's what Jesus is saying in context here. It's difficult to be my disciple. So, I have a series of messages, and I'm sure that I'll preach them here sometime, and they're based off of a title of a book that was just tremendous, and some of you may have heard them. In fact, they may have been preached here at some time before. But there was a book out called Are You a Fan or a Follower? And I believe this passage of Scripture right here is talking about that. Jesus has a lot of fans, people that have received Him, and yay, Jesus forgave me of my sin. Yay, Jesus is the Savior. Yay, Jesus is the Son of God. But a fan stops right there. A follower says, yay, Jesus is the Savior. Yay, Jesus is the Son of God. And I'm going to do my best to serve Him and live a life that's pleasing to Him and lead other people to Him. And so Jesus, in context here, is speaking to that group of people and saying, listen to me. We're applying the things that I've just taught to you, and you need to know that the way of living the life I've just taught you from the beginning of chapter 5 till now is a difficult way, and few there be that find it. Now, you know what that means? That means that there's few people that it doesn't mean that they're not getting to heaven. Now, stay with me because I'm going to get back to the principle side that applies here. But contextually, he's saying, it's hard to be my disciple. To truly live after me requires sacrifice, submission, solitude. You know what that is? That's picking up your cross daily. Now, I'm not going to ask for a show of hands, but I would wonder in here that if those were the qualifications, submission, sacrifice, suffering, and solitude, he says it throughout Scripture. I'm not trying to paint a dim picture. What I'm trying to do is paint the picture that Jesus was saying. If you choose to follow me all the way, there's going to be a price to be paid for that. You're going to lose friends along the way. Now, I know we've been hearing this gospel of everything's wonderful and you come to Christ and just... Listen, if you're going to be a deeply devoted... And that's what he's saying. He's not saying you ain't going to make it. He's saying it's difficult to be my disciple and to follow me in that way. It's hard to be a follower. It's a little easier to be a fan. Wide is the gate and the way of the fan. Right? But narrow is the gate of the disciple, and few there are that find it. And the reason the gate is narrow is because we have no room if we choose that gate to carry all the things we want to carry with us through that gate. If you go through the wide gate, you can be a fan and you can still carry some of those things. Some of those things that we aren't willing to give up for Him. Some of those things that are going to carry us through the rest of our life. Now here's what it says. That word destruction there, when it's translated out correctly, and you look it up in the Greek and you extrapolate it out, that means ruin or waste. It doesn't mean death. It means ruin or waste. So what he's saying here, those who choose the wide gate and the easy way are going to live a life of ruin here. They're not going to get everything that I have for them. You'll get some of it, you just won't get it all. But if you choose the narrow way, you get it all. You get it all. Now that's the context in which he was teaching it. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. All of those things are referring. In fact, if you go over to Luke's account of this, now, it wasn't the Sermon on the Mount that Luke was writing about. It was another time when Jesus had come down into the valley and somebody walked up to him and said, are there going to be many that get saved? And he looked at him and he said, you need to strive to enter through the narrow gate. Now, the word strive, when you look that up, means to agonize or to work diligently and hard. And we don't work or agonize over our salvation. So contextually, he's talking about the way of the disciple. If you're going to be a true disciple of mine, you need to know you're going to experience difficulty. But how many of you know the difficulty has its rewards? Amen. If we truly believe everything on this life is temporary, we look at things differently. And I've got to tell you, these are hard sayings of Jesus. But here's what we need to understand about the fan. The fan still makes it to heaven. But they don't get their full inheritance that He has for them here on the earth because they don't diligently follow Him and seek Him and seek His ways. His ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. So that's what makes this difficult. Now, let's look at the, not just the contextualized, but let's look at the principal teaching of Jesus. The principle is, it's hard to become a Christian in this regard because of what we feel like. He knows us of what we feel like we have to give up. We know that to become a child of God is an act of His grace, right? Nothing we can do to earn salvation. It is a gift of God. You don't earn a gift. Somebody just extends a gift to you, right? And then the only thing about a gift that you are involved in is the receiving of the gift. And so to be saved, all we have to do is receive the gift of God. There's no striving. There's no agonizing. I couldn't believe it when I looked that word up and it says to agonize over it. Listen, when you get saved, when you receive Christ as your Savior, there's no agony involved in that. There's jubilation involved in that. There's excitement and joy involved in that. But the principle of it is the same. If you look over in Luke, in that account in Luke, I think it's Luke chapter number 13. If you look over there, you'll see and do the digging into the Greek, into the context of which he's saying, you'll see the same thing. But he says there that he's responding to the question that someone asked him, are there going to be few that are saved? And his answer is, principally, yes. Relative to the entire population of the world, there's going to be few that get saved. But then his next phrase is talking about pursuing, if you want a guarantee, how many of you are ever struggled with that passage of scripture that says you got to work out your own salvation with fear and trembling? Now, if we know salvation is not by works, yet we're taught by Paul that we got to work out our salvation. What he's inferring there is we already have salvation. What we need to do is live a life that shows that we are saved, not just to others, but to ourselves. And that's the life that Jesus is talking about. That's the life where we have self-sacrifice. We're willing to give up some things. So lest you think you're not a person that gives up some things, you're here tonight. You gave up what you could be doing tonight. So there is sacrifice involved in our following Christ. When you come to church on Sunday, you're giving up your Sunday mornings, especially if you come during football season. You're giving up the NFL today. And all those great shows that come on before the games. We sacrifice, and I'm being funny right there, but Jesus calls us to a life as disciples. That's why he only had 12 and then only 70, and then the rest of the people he called folks that are following after him or looking at or chasing after him, just wanting to be around where he is. That's what church is today. But a true disciple of Christ is a Monday through Sunday disciple, where you're giving up your time to study more of the scripture, where you're giving up your way to be led by the Holy Spirit, where you're giving up your pride by sharing the gospel with other, giving up your fears by sharing the gospel with other people, giving up your pride by being identified with Christ. So, does anybody have any questions or comments about that in relation to the contextual teaching of Jesus and the principal teaching of Jesus, and that they can be both found in the same passage of Scripture?
Because the Word of God is living.
Yeah, it's living. The Word of God is living and breathing. So you can find both of those things. All right, before we go, I got a lot of blank stares tonight for the first time on Wednesday night and forever. So I don't want to go too fast past this. I want to make sure that we're all... And if one of you want to look at me and say, Pastor, you're crazy, let's talk about that. We might be here a while. We might not finish tonight if we talk about... But anybody? Comments? Brother James?
When a preacher is talking, he tells his audience, you might give up everything you love to become a Christian.
Listen, there's a difference between being a believer and being a disciple. It's the fan follower thing. Okay? So, yes, sir.
A lot of people before they're saved, they're right on the edge and they're fretting over this. They're worried. They know they're not doing right. When they finally do find the right path and get saved, do you suppose there's so much relief and self-confidence that many of them just don't become a faith? They get lax.
Sure, I think that happens to us. I think that happens to a lot of people, actually. That look, if given this definition, or given, let's do the fan follower thing because it's easier for me to do, or let's do believer disciple. If I were to ask you the question right now, could you name me two or three people that you felt like, if you had to judge, and we know we're not supposed to judge, but if you had to look at their life and determine whether they were a fan or a follower, could you name three people that you would consider followers of Christ? Now, remembering that followers of Christ are sacrificing a great deal. Fully devoted followers of Christ, disciples of Christ. And it could be you. It might be you. Anybody? Yes, ma'am.
You want to name three people?
If you have one, you can just name one. Alicia on Sunday. Sister-in-law. Well, that's a great contemporary example right there. Somebody else. Y'all think I'm asking trick questions tonight. Nobody wants to say anything. How about, would you consider Billy Graham? Maybe one of those disciples that gave up a lot to pursue what he pursues. Reinhard Bonnke. Anybody else got some names? Yes, sir. Martin Luther King. Follower of Christ that gave up so much for the cause that Christ had placed in his life. Anybody else? Come on, we should be on a roll now. You're kind of getting the, okay.
Harold Presley, our missionary
to England.
He's really been an example.
Yeah, Harold Presley, our missionary to England. So we all have people in our life, and maybe even we might consider ourselves that. But the measuring stick is not others. The measuring stick is, well, my life is certainly more committed to Christ than so-and-so. The measuring stick is Matthew chapters 5 through 7. That's the measuring stick we are to measure our life against, Christ. That's why when I pray, I always pray, say, God, continually mold us and shape us into the image of your Son. And I got to tell you, there's a lot of me that doesn't look like Jesus at all. So it is a life pursuit that requires that. But the principle teaching is also true of salvation. It is difficult because people feel like they're going to have to give up, or they feel like they're not worthy. And that's why he made it a gift. Because if we earned salvation because we felt like we were worthy, we would never be saved. We'd never be saved. Yes?
I said this one time since we started this study, and I'll say it again. The heart of Christ as he taught, because I mean, he clearly shows that the things that are difficult lead to life. I think what he's trying to say is that these things may seem difficult, but they bring life. And, you know, doing it your own way may seem easier, but then it's going to lead to ruin. It's going to lead. So, you know, he loves his disciples. He's teaching them here.
Yeah.
And he's just giving them a heads up that, you know, all these things that I'm teaching may seem difficult, but they're going to bring life and they're going to take you to where you want to go. But, you know, doing it your own way and, you know, kicking against
the goats.
The way,
yeah.
You know, like Christ has told us to, you know, you're not going to have life.
Right. What does he say? That's where I was going to go. She just said, you're not going to have life and have it more abundantly. He says in John 10:10 that the thief comes to kill, steal, and destroy, but he's come that we might have life and have it more abundantly. What we have to do is define abundant life according to Scripture and not according to the world. Because the world has a definition of abundant life that looks nothing like the picture that Christ gives us in Scripture. And He didn't come so we can have abundant life in heaven, because when you get to heaven, you're not going to have need for abundance of anything. Heaven's overflowing. So the abundant life he has for us is the life that he wants us to live now. And he says, and if you want all of that, you can get some of it, but if you want all of it, you're going to have to walk through that narrow gate that is so narrow that when you walk through, all the things that you want to hold on to are scraped off. And it becomes a life that is fully devoted to following me. And he knew that we were going to need jobs. He knew we were going to have families. He knew all of that. And so he knew that even within that, that if we pursued him, the Holy Spirit would be the one that would enable us to be able to do this. We can't just do it by reading it. We have to have the help, the leadership, the guidance, the strength, and the power of the Spirit of God. So God is challenging us to be followers, realizing that we may be making earthly sacrifices. But you know, in Scripture it told us that we are to pick up our cross daily. Now, I've never seen a picture of a cross that people were carrying that looked easy or light or even pleasant to the eye. But what it did do was it showed a sign of sacrifice that they're willing to pay for their Savior. Not for their salvation, but for their Savior. We don't work to get saved. We don't work for Jesus to get saved. We don't do things to get saved. We do things because we're saved. And that's what he's trying to teach us here. When you come to know me, you begin to pursue me and chase after me because I saved you. So pursue the narrow gate and the narrow way, because the wide gate leads to ruin. And if we took the time to process that out in our own individual lives, we can see places, we would be able to look back and see places in our lives that we weren't pursuing God, and ruin accompanied that time. Now, I'm not talking about, look, life is difficult because we live in a fallen world, but when you walk away from God and you try to do it on your own, this is what God does. You got it? Okay. Take it. Have at it. Right. So he wants us to pursue him. Everybody good? Anybody else? Comments or questions about this passage of Scripture? It don't look like we're going to finish, does it?
You mentioned the Scripture, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. And the enabler is in that next verse. It says, and you know this.
Yeah.
For it's God who is working in you to do his will and his good pleasure.
You can't even do it yourself. Yeah, it has to be the Holy Spirit that does it. And working out your own salvation, by the mere structure of the sentence, says you already have your salvation. Now you're working it out by the way that you live, by the way that you pursue me, by the way that you chase after me, by your desires changing. In Scripture, it tells us that he will give us the desires of our heart, but the Scripture right before that says, delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Because when we delight ourselves in the Lord, our desires change. We want that second half of the Scripture without the first half sometimes. We want those desires to be given to us. But he says, if you'll delight in me, I'll change your desires and it'll be easy for me to give them to you, because your desires will line up with mine. All right? Good stuff. Everybody good? Hallelujah. Yes, ma'am, Miss Susie. That's right. It does. And the knowledge of his grace and mercy. His grace and mercy does not just stop at the moment of our salvation. His grace and mercy follows after us as we continue to pursue him. Because when we fall and fail, and he knows that we will, he is right there with his grace and mercy to set us right back up and to continue to move in the direction toward him. And so we're grateful for his grace and his mercy, and it continues to pursue us. Anybody else? We might as well just park right here because it's 7:56. Y'all got one more week of Sermon on the Mount in you?
Yes.
Everybody, wave at me if you got one more week. I want to see every one of you back here next Wednesday now. If you stay home, I'm going to think that You didn't have one more week. We will finish next week, because while the rest of it is deep and good, it's not as deep as this is. I saw another hand right here.
I was just going to say that, you know, by the same token that we can't earn our salvation by works, man, the evidence, our works isn't evidence of our salvation.
Exactly.
By the same way, apathy or lack of works on our part, like a consistent lifestyle that isn't, like what you would call a fan,
yeah,
that isn't in conformity to the gospel of Christ, can also be an evidence of our lack of salvation. Just like in the passage with the sheep and the goats. He didn't say, you know, you call on my name a lot, you call on my name a little bit, you're good. He didn't even say, you know, you call on my name, you didn't. Everyone who approached the throne of God said, Lord, Lord.
Yeah.
And he said, you know, not only, God, I'm great. You both called on me. You're my fans, you're my followers. But he said, you know what, you followed up with a life of righteousness and obedience, and you didn't. So you may call me Lord, and you may think that you're my fan, you may think that you're my follower. You may even think that I'm Lord, just like James 2 says, where it says, you know, even the demons,
oh, yeah,
know that he is Lord, and they tremble. But, you know, it has, it takes both.
There's going to be a day, and I forget if it's this passage. I think it's the passage in Luke. It's after he says that, or no, I think it's right here. He says, in that day, you will call me, you will say. That day changes the context of where he was teaching from the Sermon on the Mount. Now he's talking about the day of judgment. And when that day comes, there's going to be some of you coming that attended church every week, paid your tithes, but you did not love me. You did not pursue me. There are going to be people, he says, that have prayed in his name to cast demons out. And he's going to look at them and say, depart from me, I never knew you. Those aren't fans, or those are certainly not followers and are not fans. Those are people who just named the name of Christ for convenience. And there are people that do that. Remember what we said? If you walk down the streets of Pensacola this weekend and did a survey and asked how many people, asked everybody there who was a Christian, the vast majority of people would say that they were Christian. And a good percentage of those have zero relationship with Christ. And some of those would have a salvation relationship with Him, but not a Lord relationship with Him. And that's what changes you from a fan to a follower, is when you make Christ Lord over your life. And not just Savior over your life. Amen?
Amen.
All right. So next week, Jesus, help me. Next week is false prophets. Yeah, a little light, but it is a little lighter than what we just covered. If you don't get anything else out of tonight, get what I said at the beginning about context and principle, and the fact that throughout the Word of God, it's important that we understand the context, because we can understand the heart of what Jesus was saying or Paul was saying when we understand the context in which it was written, who he was writing to, when he was writing it, when he was saying it. But also within that context, there are principles that apply for us today in our life. This is the application of the contextual Word of God, and there are, in these passages of scriptures, even when we get into the false prophets, you're going to see context, and you're also going to see principle that Jesus is teaching us here. So as we continue in whatever Bible study, I will every once in a while remind us of the context and the principle that is happening. Because we know that there is, that Tammy said it the best, it is the living Word of God. It didn't die when it was written on paper. It is alive inside of us today because Jesus is the Word. Amen. In the beginning was the Word. Yes, sir. Yeah, put that on the, if you don't see one of us, just drop it in that basket back there that's for the Connect cards. Just drop them in there. We'll pick those up and we'll take a look at them. It'll give me another week now to pray over them and decide where we're going to go after we finish the Sermon on the Mount. It's good to have Mike and Judy Wood back in church with us after their trips, and good report from the Lord. Yes, sir.
So we've got another July 27th, we have to go back for another prophet verse. But I want to tell you, the lady doctor was probably late 30s or early 40s. She spent an hour with us.
Wow.
And before we left, I asked her if we said a prayer for her. So we both prayed for her. And she hugged us both. And she said, "You're one of the nicest couples I've ever met."
Hallelujah.
And she really seemed, I could see a tear pop out of her. I thought we might have struck the floor.
Yes, sir. Amen. Living the life everywhere we go, never missing an opportunity to promote Jesus and make His name and His fame more widely known.
And don't forget, leave a tip.
She's got that on her tonight. She's having real bad memories tonight. Saturday night prayer, okay? Let's come and let's pray together on Saturday. Looking forward to a tremendous service. The Lord has just been meeting with us in extraordinary ways. And I believe it's because of the heart and the desire of the people that God comes and does that. So please continue to pray. Join us on. And it was so wonderful to hear the report. What a great report. It says, "You look too healthy to give chemo to. Just go and enjoy life. We'll check you out again in a little while longer." So we thank God for the good report. Let's pray and just adds God's blessings and the sealing power of the Holy Spirit over His word tonight. Father, we thank You, Lord, for Your word. We thank You that it is an alive today word. Now, we know all of the word is truth, but Holy Spirit, we know that You reveal truth to us. So, Father, tonight in the challenging words of Jesus, let all of our heart's desires be to desire to be a follower, a disciple of Christ. Help us to move in those places where we appear to just be fans, to seek the power of God through our relationship with the Holy Spirit to become followers and disciples. Thank You, Lord, for Your grace and Your mercy. Thank You for the saving power of Jesus on the cross, who has forgiven us and continues to forgive us. Our desire, Lord, is to make You more famous than You've ever been. In our lifetimes, to declare the name of Jesus, to carry a message of love, hope, and forgiveness to a world that is confused and lost and dying. Through the power of Your word and the work of Your Holy Spirit, continually mold us and shape us into the image of Your Son so that we can point people to Jesus by the way we live, act, move, and have our being. We thank You for it. Thank You for good reports. Thank You for Your healing power that is flowing throughout our congregation, touching and healing Your people, God. We receive that tonight in the name of Jesus. Now, Lord, as we come together on Saturday for a time of prayer and Sunday for a day of celebrating You, worshiping You, glorifying You, we submit ourselves to You until then in Jesus' name. Amen. Don't forget to drop your papers off tonight.